Hey there, guys, welcome to lesson number 17. We're really starting to get some progress done with this eye now. As you can probably see from the last lesson, I've added a little bit more value into the upper and lower areas of the eye. And I've done that because if you actually look at our reference, there are some very important highlights, some parts of the skin that are reflecting some of the light, and also in the white of the eye as well. So we've got to get enough value down on there, and don't let your brain trick you into thinking that this light area at the top and below the eye as well are going to be white. So we don't want to leave those white at all. So I've continued using my HB and 2B in some of the areas. What we're going to be focusing on today is this upper right hand corner. So this area here today, I'm going to be getting some of these hairs in. So we're going to be mainly focusing on a 2B, a 4B, and I'm also going to use a little bit of a 7B, just a very dark pencil in there as well. And I'm going to be using my Mono Zero eraser. This is a retractable mechanical eraser, almost like the mechanical pencils that we use. And of course, I'm going to be using my kneaded eraser and our soft brush. So I'm going to start with the 2B pencil. It's been really fantastic seeing some of your work recently over on the Facebook page. It's been really nice seeing some of the eyes, but there's been a few new members that have just started recently with some of the spheres in the barrel, so it's fantastic to see that. Okay, so starting with this 2B pencil, what I'm doing is I'm just going to start, let me get this reference in there as well. So what I'm starting to do here, because we've actually got some very light coloured hair, is I'm going to start building the value up in the darker areas. So I'm just picking out some of the shaded areas, the spaces in between the hair, and using my tapered stroke, I'm just going to start to develop those. The thing with drawing light coloured hair is a pencil line is never ever going to represent a light hair. So just remember that you're never going to be able to make a pencil stroke look like a blonde hair, or in this instance across here we've got some very, very light hair, some almost white hair. So in order to bring out the whiter hairs, we need to use our eraser. So what we're doing is we're building up some of the darker areas with the 2B initially, and then we're actually going to take the value out. So you can see that this edge that I've drawn up to here is up to this edge here. So I know that everything beyond that is lighter. Then we've got this dark section, then we've got another light section. So I'm going to need to fill out a lot of this with, like I say, the 2B pencil, moving into some of the softer pencils as well in the darker areas. Now, this area up here is very important because this is going to give us contrast for the rest of the drawing, and it's going to then allow me to see how much more value I need to apply in the rest of the eye. I hope you're enjoying these lessons as much as I am enjoying making them. I've had some brilliant comments from some of you over on the Facebook page. If you've not found our Facebook page yet, if you type in the search bar at the top of your Facebook app on your mobile phone or on your PC, if you type in Tutorial Tuesdays from Beginner to Pro and just request to join the group, I'll accept that. And I'm obviously posting these videos up there, but I sort of created the group because I wanted to try and teach people to have a sort of a basic structure of how to draw. I mean, I know that I fumbled along for the first couple of years, going from various different methods, and I took lots of online classes and things like that, but I sort of fumbled my way around, and I wanted to try and put something together that was sort of the best bits of what I've learned. It's important that you have an understanding, a basic understanding and a structure of what you're trying to do, rather than, which I'm guessing what a lot of you guys started out with doing, is watching a video here, watching a video there, trying to muddle techniques together. So in some cases using blending stumps, in some cases using charcoal, and then others trying to use graphite, and really just trying to feel your way through. And although I'm a firm believer that self-teaching is the best way, I look back at when I wanted to do anything in my life, it was a matter of me wanting to do it rather than me being told I'd got to do it, which is something that happens a lot at school. And as soon as I found that I wanted to do something, I found the learning much easier. But understanding and having a sort of a roadmap of how to get things done and what order to do them, I think, is very, very important. And hopefully the methods that I'm trying to teach you and the points that I'm trying to get across, although they're not the only methods of art and drawing, I do feel that it's a foundation. If you can create something with just the pencils and an eraser, if you then want to move on to doing more work with a charcoal and maybe using blending stumps and things like that, you've always got the fundamentals and the foundations there. Now, what I'm trying to teach you here is, firstly, I'm trying to teach you how to lay the pencils down, how to use this type of technique of layering, and not smudging, so that we've got complete control over our drawing. But what I'm also trying to teach you is how light works and how we make things look realistic. So how we make a face look contoured and how we make an eyeball look white without having to just leave the whites of the paper there. So I'm coming up into this top corner now. Now it's quite difficult to see exactly how this is going to look, because obviously my drawing, the paper that I'm using, is bigger than this, what I've got here. So I'm just going to go as far as up as I think I need to go here. Obviously I don't need to go all the way to this top corner unless I wanted to do that. But like I say, these projects that we're doing, they're certainly not for me to be finishing them off to masterpiece level. They are really there for the purpose of just teaching you guys some of the methods and some of the ideas that I've been doing for the last couple of years, or 3 years or so now, and giving you an understanding. And also, I think it's really nice being part of a community and drawing these things together. It's fantastic seeing some of your work online. You know, it's an image that I've sort of found online and obviously thought that it was going to be a decent enough image for us to have a go at. And then seeing people from all over the world drawing the same thing as me, I think that's wonderful. And we've had a few people join that are saying that the group's, you know, one of the best groups that they've been in recently. And I know that I'm pretty sick of a lot of online art groups, if I'm being honest with you. It's the same old nonsense. It's people putting spam on there and self-promoting, which I've got no problem with a bit of self-promotion. I think it's very important that we are able to get our work out there, but they're not offering anything back. So you only ever see rate my video, rate my drawing, and how does this drawing compare, and things like that. And although there's definitely space online for that, I just like the way that this group's starting to come together. You know, we're sitting at around about 2,000 members now, and we've not really had an awful lot of the nonsense that you certainly see in a lot of the art groups. So thank you guys for doing that and making it what it is. So what I've got to be aware of here is this is not all hair. This is shadowed area. With the light hair above it. So I do need to lay some of this graphite down in a rather smooth fashion. So I will be layering some of the HB into that as well, just to make sure that I'm getting deep down into the tooth of the paper. We don't want a speckledy look. We want a nice coverage like we've got here, because this is actually almost the same value as in there. Obviously, we've decided that the light is coming from this top left angle, and we can see that by the iris and the way that the shine is on the eye itself, it's in that top left corner. So we want a nice smooth coverage in here. What I'm going to do is I'm going to get some value down into these areas. And then I'm going to start to brush the graphite around and then start taking out some very fine hairs, like I say, with my Mono Zero razor. Had a really good question the other day on the group, and it was answered fantastically well, as always, by members. But somebody asked if these kneaded erasers rub out like a normal eraser, and they don't. They don't crumble off. So you can use these for years. There's been a few people asking how you refresh it. So I will always, before sitting down, if you can see what I'm doing with this, I just start to pull it apart and just remold it. And what that does is it just distributes some of the value and some of the graphite that you've got on there, and evens it out, and then make it into a nice ball. So that tends to be what I would do at the start of each drawing session, particularly if it's a commission that I'm working on for somebody. My checklist will always be hands washed, working area clean. There's nothing on there that's going to get onto the paper itself or the drawing. I make sure that my pencils are sharpened and that my light is coming in from the left-hand side. I'm a right-hander, so I want the light coming in from the left-hand side, so that, as you can see, the cast shadow from my pencil now is leaning away from my pencil, from where the lead is touching the paper. If I had it the other way round, the shadow would actually be obscuring where I'm actually trying to draw. So that's a really important one. I know a lot of you probably are drawing maybe in a dining room or something like that, on a dining room table. That's certainly where I started out drawing. And you've probably got an overhead light, which makes it quite difficult to get the cast shadow to fall to the right of the pencil lead if you're a right-hander, or to the left if you're a left-hander. So you have to work with what you've got. You can buy quite cheap lights that just connect to a table or a chair. They are pretty good. I had a few of those that I got from Amazon. I find Amazon's a fantastic website to buy most of your art supplies. I also use various different UK-based online art shops. So just shop around for these various things, but don't get caught up in the, I think we've spoken about this before, but don't get caught up in this idea of the most expensive pencil or the most expensive eraser is going to be the best. You can produce fantastic work with some quite ordinary, certainly ordinary costing products. I personally use Caran d'Ache pencils. These are called Caran d'Ache Graph Wood, and I like the way that they lay down. There's very little grit in the lead. I'm sure that you've all at some point felt a bit of grit in the lead, and that's when you just feel like you're scratching the paper. What I'd recommend for you to do there is just give it a quick whirl in the pencil sharpener, just to get rid of that. I've tried getting rid of it on the paper itself before, and marking the paper or applying too much value in certain areas. So a quick whirl. If you have a nail file or a piece of sandpaper to hand, there's a lot of artists that will use that to shape the end of the pencil. Some people like a slightly chiseled edge, maybe a fine point for certain things. So an emery board, I think that's what you call them, a nail file board that a lot of ladies will use to file the edges of their nails down, is quite handy to have. I've not got one with me at the minute. I'm trying to teach you the raw method. And once you've done that, you can add on to it. I'm going to show you a little trick that I'm going to use later on, that if I've got time, I'll put it in this video. And it's one that a lot of the art teachers that certainly I would have first started learning from would turn in their grave if they saw me doing it. But it's something that I picked up, and it's like I've said, I'm going to show you the things that I feel have worked for me. They're not the only way, they're not necessarily the best way, but they've worked for me, and I've gone from a pretty average artist, I would say, to being quite happy with my work. And I think that's a good gauge. You know, when you look at your work over a period of time and you look at things and you go, do you know what? I'm quite happy with that. You know, there is always things that we can do better. I don't think we should ever aspire to be perfect, because it drives people insane. So yeah, back on point. I'm just trying to get you to understand the principles that I feel make a good, solid foundation for you to then go on to be able to use colour pencils or markers or pen and ink, ballpoint pens. Some of you might have seen some of my scribble arts that I do. I've not done one for a while, actually. I've been very busy recently, so it's been difficult to fit all the drawings in that I want to do. But yeah, I do like doing some pen and ink work, and the principles that I'm trying to share with you during these tutorials are exactly the same no matter what medium that you're using. Okay, so I'm going to just brush some of that value in now, making sure that I get it as spread as I can, just softening some of those lighter values out. So I'm going to come in with my HB. There it is. Again, because we've got quite a dark value in here, and I want to make sure that it's very saturated in the paper. And by saturated, I mean I don't want any of these white specks. And you can see the difference between this area and this area. I've only gone up to a 4B in this area, and I've already laid down a 2B in this initial area that I'm working on now. And you can see that it's nowhere near as dark. And it's nowhere near as dark because what I haven't done yet in this area is I haven't layered. So I'm layering an HB now over the top of this. And you can see that it is slightly changing value. I'm starting to get some graphite down into the deeper recesses of the tooth of this paper. Like I've said, it's important that we get this contrast up in this upper right corner, because it's then going to give us an idea of how much value we need to bring into the iris, into the dark area to the right of the eye. Without this, and I consider it's clearly the hair, but it's not all hair. But what I find is I tend to leave the hair of my portraits till almost the end. And it's very difficult to understand and get a real feeling for how much value you've got down and how much value you need to get down in the facial features until you've put the hair on. And once you start putting the hair on, I think if you cast your mind back to the baby portrait that we did, once we started to apply the hair, it sort of brings the whole piece together. It finalizes things, and you can see where you've got to take away a little bit of value, and you can see where you've got to add a little bit of value. And I think this is going to be one of those opportunities, certainly in this area here. And then it's the eyelashes. And then we're almost there. So if you've not already subscribed to the channel, make sure you do that and turn on the bell notification icon, which is just next to the subscribe button. And all that does is it just notifies you when a new video is released. So you don't miss it. You can be the first there. Don't forget to give the videos a like and a comment. That just allows me to push a few more of my videos out to people that aren't necessarily already subscribed. It just makes YouTube say, hey, people are liking this content because they're hitting the thumbs up button or they're sharing it. Sharing's another real important factor, but it'd be really great for you to do that. You know, obviously if you like the video, if you don't like it, then don't bother. If you've got any recommendations, if there's something you'd like me to cover one week, or there's something you'd like me to show you, or something that maybe I've gone over in a video before and you don't quite understand, then leave me a comment down below, either on the video or get hold of me on the Facebook page. I do try and answer everybody's questions. I'm finding it more difficult to do that as the group's growing. You know, like I say, we're sort of sitting at about 2,000 members, and as you can imagine, some mornings when you wake up, it's there's a lot of traffic on there. So I'm going to come in with my 2B again now and just start to draw in some of these darker strands of hair. Like I said earlier, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to get into the negative spaces of the hair. And we're going to then use the graphite that's available to us when we brush it around and take some of the much lighter strands of hair out with our eraser. And we're going to do a process of layering that. So again, I'm just finding these darker areas. Still using my 2B pencil here. Again, using our tapered stroke. If you don't know what the tapered stroke is, if this is the first time that you've sort of come to my channel, go and check out videos 1 to 5. I go through all of that, but very briefly, a tapered stroke is, on this video, it might look as though what I'm doing is scribbling. But what I'm actually doing is I'm pulling the pencil towards me with every stroke. So pulling towards me, and then lifting the pencil off of the paper as I get towards the end of the stroke. What that does is it builds up over the duration of, or the patch that I'm working in, it builds up hundreds and hundreds of these very delicate lines. The benefit of that is we're not damaging the tooth of the paper. We're keeping the tooth of the paper intact. And that allows us to do things like this. So if I take my Mono Zero eraser now and I make sure that there's no residue on there. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to focus on some of these lighter strands here. So we can see we've got a strand that comes out there, and I can take out some very accurate strands of hair. Particularly in this dark corner of the hair there. So I've got this wonderful opportunity now to take this, I hope you can see this in the camera, to take this white hair out. Now if I'd have been using a blending stump in this area here particularly, I would not, absolutely not be able to do that. So what I'd then have to do is maybe use a white pencil or an ink pen, a gel pen or something like that, which again, I've got absolutely No problem doing that. A lot of my cartoon work, I've used that. I use white pens and white pencils and things like that. But this is how I learned to draw. If I can get value and I can get highlights without having to use anything other than a pencil and an eraser, and I can make the person looking at my work believe that what they're looking at is realistic, it's got this photographic quality to it, then I've done my job. Now, if you then want to go on and build your skills and your repertoire of artistic flair up, fantastic. I'm pretty sure that the architects that have gone and built some of the world's most unbelievable buildings all started off with some very simple rules, some very simple ideas that they then implement even in their most masterful pieces of work. And I'm an absolute believer in getting the basics right. And once we've got the basics right, you can then go and experiment. I don't like that this harsh line of value that I've got in there, so I'm just going to soften that up with my kneaded eraser there. I don't want that line necessarily in there. And that will fade as I brush and add more value in these other areas. So we're starting now, as you can see, to be building up this structure. You can see some of these white hairs coming through. So I can now see that I need some more value. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start working with my 4B pencil now in some of those areas that I've now created with the eraser, and just start to bring some of those values out. And as I darken up the edges closest to some of these highlighted lines, I then have an opportunity to bring some of these hair forward, some of them push them back, constantly looking for these areas. But as I'm now starting to add some of this 4B into these areas, I'm starting to get some more contrast. So what appeared to be just quite a faint hair now starts to look much more prominent because I'm building up the value around it. And that is such an important skill to have. It allows you to build the realism up without going too dark initially, or without using too much pressure with your eraser trying to take out a white hair. I've done the job with the white hair already. I've taken some of the value out of the paper, and that's always going to be less value now. Even if I go over this and I brush, which I will do, I will be brushing value into the lighter area, but that's always going to be the lightest area. So the value is not going to build up at the same rate as the hairs around it, for the simple reason that I've already got a layer in the surrounding areas, and whatever value I put on top of that makes that area darker. And although it's making the lighter area darker, so that the hair follicle or whatever you want to call it, it's always staying one or two shades less than the hair that we've worked on. Or that's the area that's going to stay a lighter shade. And then you've always got the opportunity to go over it again, take some value out, and then brush and go over it. And when we go into some of our animal portraits, that's definitely going to be a technique that we're going to be using a lot. So it's that constant layering. So I'm just going to work around the edge of this beautiful hair that's just sitting out. And it's these very subtle opportunities that we get to really bring a drawing to life. I'm just going to make it slightly thinner so that it looks more like a hair rather than a strike of an eraser. And as I bring the value up around the edge of that hair, it alters the contrast and it gives me that beautiful opportunity to make that hair look even lighter. So I can see I need much more value in this area. And I'm going to try and get this a fair bit darker before I start to take any more hairs, because there's a lot going on in this area. We've got some crisscrossing of hairs in there as well. We've got some much darker, make sure that that's all in view. We've got some much darker values up in this area. Now, when you're drawing hairs, this is it's one of the reasons why I picked this drawing, actually, because it's quite close up and we can work almost with some individual strands. But if you're doing a portrait for somebody and you can see a full head of hair, what's really important that we do is we work in clumps. So you're not going to draw, let's say that we were drawing a portrait of Marilyn Monroe, and she's got this iconic, very blonde, curly hair. You're not going to work on the individual strands in the same way that we are doing with this. What you're going to do is you're going to look for clumps, but we will do some separate tutorials on hair. The most difficult ones, I think, are blonde hair, curly hair, African hair, so very tight curly hair, can be, when I say difficult, if you understand how to do it, if you understand the technique, nothing's really difficult. You can draw anything, but I guess again it's one of those things that gives people a bit of a hard time initially, and they don't know where to start with it. So we'll break those sort of hairstyles down, those types of hair down separately. But I thought this was a pretty good project to do, because obviously we've got a lot of what we did in the initial lessons, a lot of the sphere work in the eye itself, and we've got a lot of detail in the iris, but we've also got the starting of some hair and blonde hair as well. So this technique of taking the blonde hairs out with an eraser is exactly what we're going to do no matter the hairstyle. If we're drawing a horse or an animal with lighter hair, it's exactly the same process. So your Mono Zero eraser is an absolute must. I would, you can probably do this with a kneaded eraser. Let me show you. So if I take my kneaded eraser and I get a very slight point and I just flatten the point out. I don't know if you can see that, but I've just flattened it out so that we've got that. Again, I can come in because I haven't damaged the tooth of the paper. And I can just take out those strands of hair. The Mono Zero eraser, what that allows you to do is it allows you to have a much more accurate method of bringing the lines out. So you can do it with a kneaded eraser, and it still gives you a very, very good look. But for me, the Mono Zero eraser is a game changer. Just making sure that you brush any excess value off. Let's layer a little bit more 2B in here now. So you can see that in this patch here, we've got HB, 2B and 4B, and we're going back to the 2B now. And I can remember when I first started out learning and drawing this type of way, I was so, I got so hooked up in asking questions like, what value or what pencil did you use in that area, and what pencil did you use in this area? And you know, artists would come back and say, oh well, I've used, you know, 6B in that area, and I've used 2B in this area. And it doesn't mean the literal sense that this is only 4B and this is only 2H. In this lighter area here, I've got some 2B. You know, I'll you know, maybe layer a very, very light amount of 2B into that area. But then what I'll do is I'll maybe remove some of the value with the kneaded eraser, and then go back over it with an HB and erase a little bit more if I feel that there's too much value there. So the final patch, the final area that you're working on, is going to have a combination of different pencils in there. And it's that combination of pencils and that layering that gives you this very smooth gradation of value from dark to light. And you know, you might have a, you know, if we look at this eye here, this dark corner here, you know, I've gone up to some 7B in this area, just a light layer of 7B in some areas, but we've got some lighter areas within the darkest area, and we've got a darker area in here. So although I've used a various different amounts of value and different grades of pencil in there, you wouldn't be able to identify one area as being 2B and one area as being HB and one area as being 2H. It's a combination, and it, for me, that's the biggest skill that I've learned over the last 3 years, is one area is not just one specific pencil. Even the white of this eye. So even the white of this eye, I've added some 4B in the corners and some 2B in this area here, but it's that constant layering, taking value out, removing value, adding value, putting some of the eraser in there. It's that what ultimately creates the look that we're after, and it's what gives you those seamless transitions from one value to another. I know I asked a question on the Facebook group a while ago now, a couple of weeks ago, and I just put something on there that said, what are the three cornerstones for drawing realism? And we had some fantastic answers out there, and I'm not saying that the three answers that I'm going to tell you now are gospel and that's it. For me, that's what I aim for in order to give me some realism. So what I say is, to draw realism and create realism, first of all, we need an accurate sketch. It doesn't matter how good your shading is. It doesn't matter how good you are at bringing highlights out and things like that. It doesn't matter how good you are at attention to detail. If the proportions are off, if the perspective is off, it doesn't matter what you do, it is never going to look realistic. People will look at your drawing, they'll go, oh, it's very good, but... And it's that but that we want to avoid. So a very, very accurate initial sketch is super important. After that, what's really important for me is very smooth transitions from your values. So you see some great work, but unfortunately the transitions aren't very smooth. And what I mean by that is the transitions from dark into lighter, dark into light, dark into light. And it's this layering process of the different pencils that gives us the opportunity to do that. And then the third thing for me, the third pillar for realism is contrast. I very rarely see people going too dark. Always see people going too light or not balancing the values out. So in your piece of work, you are absolutely going to need mid-tones, light tones and dark tones. Now, again, I'm still not completely satisfied with my balancing of the contrast yet. We're still laying value down. That's why I wanted to get this area done tonight. But I think it's very clear to see that we have got some very dark values. We've got some very light highlighted areas. Dark, 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 mid-tones and highlights throughout the entire drawing. So for me, they are the critical areas to look for. You know, people will say that accurate shadows and things like that and direction of light, yep, all of them are still very important. But for me, when I'm drawing for realism, that's what I aim for. Accuracy of my sketch, smooth transitions between the values and contrast. And if I was to say which one of those is the most important, I'd probably say contrast for me. Because that's the one that I used to struggle with the most. You know, I look back at some of my older drawings now and they're very washed out. And what I mean by washed out is they were all mid-tones. Mid-tones and a highlight, I would say. So I've got lots of drawings, lots of bits of work that I've done that I thought at the time were fantastic and I was super happy with them. But if I looked at them now, in fact, well, probably over the coming months, I'll probably get a few of my older drawings out and just show you how to ramp the contrast up in them, and just show you how much of a difference it will make. Obviously, I've sprayed a lot of my drawings with fixative, so I might have to be barbaric with some of them and go in and use, I don't know, a colour pencil or something in the darkest areas. But it's probably quite a good lesson to actually have a go at. So I'll make a note of that. I think that might be quite a good lesson. So, I think I'm going to give this another brush. And then I'm going to start to take a few more hairs out and I'm going to cross over. In certain areas. So we've got. Just make sure sometimes when you're using these erasers that you just take the build up off of the tip. It can sometimes build up and make it difficult to get some of these beautiful faint lines. I just love seeing some of these lines appear. And it's this is the entire reason why we build the values up the way we do. For these opportunities to bring these hairs out and have that one crossing over here. So by brushing over the value, which is what I was talking about earlier, it then gives me the opportunity to have a hair crossing another hair. And what that does is it builds up depth and it builds up layers. And obviously we've not got an awful lot of hair in here, but we have got enough to just start to build up that realism. Somebody did an eye a couple of weeks ago and the eye was fantastic. I really, really liked the eye. It's the same one that we're doing now. And they'd gone a little bit further than the lessons had. And they'd added some eyelashes in there. And my only criticism with it, and constructive criticism, of course, which is what we all need from time to time, was the eyebrows looked a little bit regimental. They looked all a similar length. There was no crossover. I can't remember who it was. If that was you, then leave me a comment down below. I can't remember who it was. There's so many of you that are really commenting and sharing some of your work and it's great, but I can't always remember who certain pictures were. So we're just building up a few of these hairs, and I'm going to brush again. And again, it's very important when we're looking at these hairs, which ones are the brightest? So I can see here we've got a very bright hair coming down here. So this area needs to be brightest. This one running across there. We've also got some bright ones up in this area, but they're not all the same level of brightness. And it's that attention to detail that's so important. So we've definitely got some darker hairs now sitting in here that are underneath, possibly further away, closer together. So I'm going to start building some of them in, looking for these shadowed areas, looking for opportunities to make one edge darker than the other. And if I can see any shadows in there, I'm bringing the shadows out. I can see straight away I need more value in this area here. It's one of the darkest areas on the picture, actually. And that's going to give me the opportunity again to make this hair look lighter. So I'm just going to continue in this fashion now. So I'm going to leave the eyelashes and the finishing touches, I think, off to the next lesson. So that will be lesson 18. I'm going to continue doing exactly what we've been doing, bringing value out into this darkest area. I'm going to start removing some of the lighter hairs with my Mono Zero razor, using my brush to brush in the value, and just repeating that. So next time you come to me, I'm going to have this right hand side of our face and our eye done, and then we're going to go onto the eyelashes. I'll show you a trick with the eyelashes and my secret tip that, like I've said, a lot of my tutors, if we'd call them that, would certainly be turning in their grave if they see me do it. But it's gonna make our drawing pop. So make sure you tune in for that. Thank you so much for watching. It's been a pleasure once again. Hope to hear from some of you from around the world, and it's been nice getting to know some of you. Had a conversation with somebody on there the other week, a couple of days ago actually, that we're going to see. Oh, who did they say they were going to see in concert? Paul McCartney, maybe, was it? I don't know, I think so. So yeah, let me know what you're up to. Don't forget, give me some ideas for some future videos. I'll try and find some reference images and, you know, what we're going to look to do. We're going to obviously look to do some animals and some hair projects and things like that, but it'll be cool to get some different ideas. So that's what we're going to continue with. I'll see you guys in lesson 18, and hopefully by then most of you will have caught up, or at least got some way into this eye, and we'll move it forwards. Thanks so much for watching. I'll see you guys in the next video. Hit subscribe, smack the notifications button, follow me on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter.